This program is brought to you by Emory University.
Good afternoon. I'm Rosemary McGee, and I'm proud to serve as director of Emory's Manuscript Archive and Rare Book Library, also known as MARBLE. And it's my pleasure to welcome you here this afternoon. Emory, as we know, is a place where poetry matters. At the very center of our campus, we have poets and poems and manuscripts and readings that speak to the very essence of who we are. As our guest poet, Sharon Olds, reminds us, poetry calls upon us to probe our deepest emotions and longings. And so this afternoon, we will once again, in what is a meaningful ritual for the Emory community, reflect upon what brings us together and our common humanity. This reading is part of the Raymond Danowski Poetry Library reading series, now in its 9th year. Previous readers in the series include such acclaimed poets as Lucille Clifton, Mary Oliver, Billy Collins, Natasha Trethewey, W.S. Merwin, Seamus Heaney, and most recently, Paul Muldoon. Just a note, Sharon Olds' poetry will continue to be on sale in the lobby after the reading, along with a broadside specifically printed for this reading, which is beautiful. And she will sign these books and broadsides in the corridor to the left of, to your left of the concert hall near where the box office is. So please join her and others there. It is fitting that Sharon Olds will be introduced by curator of literary collections, as well as a curator of the Raymond Danowski Poetry Library, Kevin Young. Kevin has got to have the largest business card here on campus because he's also the Atticus Haygood Professor of Creative Writing and English, and someone who knows deeply about the multiple dimensions of the care and nurturing of poetry. Indeed, Kevin is the award-winning author of 8 books of poetry and 7 other works at last count. He writes on music, food, grief, race, and love, all the topics that sustain and concern us. His most recent volume of poetry, Just Out, Book of Hours, has already been named one of the essential poetry titles for 2014, as referenced in the American Scholar. It is a compact day book of grief. He acknowledges and fully experiences life's passages from birth to death and to all that happens in between and beyond. Interviewed by Terry Gross on Fresh Air recently, Kevin noted that for him, poetry and music are intertwined. The music is not behind it, it's not in front of it, it is it. Music and the blues, he says, they have taught me a lot. His poetry teaches us a lot about birth, death, language, music, and the inner life. Thus, there is no person better suited to introduce this evening's special guest than my colleague, poet Kevin Young.
Thank you so much, Rosemary, for that lovely introduction of my introduction. It's my honor tonight to introduce Sharon Olds. Before I do, I'd like to thank some of the organizations that have made this season of the Raymond Danowski Poetry Library Reading Series possible, namely the Hightower Family Fund, Emory Libraries, the Manuscript Archives and Rare Book Library, and the AJC Decatur Book Festival. I'd also tonight like to name some of the individuals who not only helped make this season of events at the Decatur Book Festival and at Emory a success, but also who have helped bring these readings to you free and open to the public for the last 9 years. Some of their names are Rosemary McGee herself, Ginger Kane, Julie Braun, Maureen McGavin, Christine Fraser, Lisa Chin, Aaron Goldsman, Paula Viteris, Darren Wong, who I don't know if he's here, and Philip Rafshoon, and many others I won't name. Please give them all a round of applause. Thanks. You know, next year is the 10th year of the reading series, which I can hardly believe. And for the 10th season, next fall, we have a lot of great things in store, starting with our poetry track at the Decatur Book Festival over Labor Day weekend. And we have some other treats in store, so please do come see us. Please also support the series. One easy and fun way, as Rosemary mentioned, is to get a broadside. It's quite beautiful, printed especially for this occasion. I love that there are three different actual images, and they're all taken from the Song of Solomon, and quite literally made up of text. So my favorite is the stomach. So you should get one of those. I think collect all three, why not? It's a very special keepsake and really helps support the series. The key to any broadside's power, of course, is its poetry. In the poetry of Sharon Olds, we find not only the unswept, which is the poem that's on the broadside, but the unsung and the unafraid. Olds is a poet, as one of her books names it, of the dead and the living, often in that order. Though she writes early on of the death of Marilyn Monroe and the language of the brag, she also writes powerfully of the death of a marriage or the syntax of family with its pleasures and inevitable pains, fancies of crumbs from under love's table. She chronicles the children, but also the father, as her foundational book from 1992 is named, and the mother, as in a poem like, "After 37 years, my mother apologizes for my childhood." She is as fearless about the body as she is about regret. But Olds is not simply a poet of memory or life's crucial, even crucible, everyday moments, but she's also a poet of fantasy, which is to say, profound metaphor. "I thought it would be a pure horror," the speaker says in telling my mother about the divorce in her last book, "but it's just home." Here's the start of Sleep Suite, its title's musical suite, opening the stanzaic room of the poem with an enervating sweetness. Here's the opening. "To end up in a hotel suite with one's nearly grown children who are sleeping is a kind of Eden." Olds is always imagining returning, a second chance, a last look, a kind of Eden, and one that's also kind, complete with the threat of being cast out. All this makes me ask, is there a poet more in tune with time than Olds? In Sleep Suite, she writes, "I'm like someone from the past allowed to come back. I am with our darlings. They are dreaming safe." In one of her best-known earlier poems, "I Go Back to 1937, from the Gold Cell, written 50 years later, the speaker imagines a very different returning in time to see her parents at the formal gates of their college and newly in love. "I want to go up to them and say, 'Stop. Don't do it. She's the wrong man. She's the wrong woman. She's the wrong woman. He's the wrong man. You are going to do things you cannot imagine you would ever do." But she doesn't. Instead, in what might be a poetic mantra, she ends, "I say, do what you are going to do, and I will tell about it." These aren't the words of a poetic observer, but poetry as witness, not just to life, but to what outlasts it. As Olds writes toward the end of Sleep Suite, "We are not, strictly speaking, mortal. We cast beloveds into the future." I love that. The beloved centers her most recent collection, Stag's Leap, which won last year's Pulitzer Prize in poetry. It is a book charting the dissolution of a 30-year marriage with forceful clarity, understated fury, and remarkable compassion. Here's a line from it. "In the last weeks, by day, we moved through the tearing apart along its length of the union, and by night, silence lay down with blindness and sang and saw." In Olds' brilliant vision, simply seeing is not enough. One must sing, which she does in this, perhaps her best book, out of a career of brilliant books, ranging from the groundbreaking poems of Satan Says in 1980 to The Power of One Secret Thing from 2008. Poems along the way gathered in her selected poems, Strike Sparks, which is essential reading for learning what Stanley Kunitz, as often quoted by her friend Lucille Clifton, said is the purpose of poetry, learning how to be human. So I would like to thank Sharon Olds, and not just for her work. Her book, Satan Says, here it is one I especially used to loan out to students back when I was first teaching 20 years ago. One student brought back the very copy I have here, which I should say I had gotten signed. Yes, I was foolishly loaning out signed Sharon Olds books, saying she dogged all the pages she liked. Dog-eared, you know, turned the pages down, which of course means she dog-eared the whole book. As someone who once collected first editions and as a curator who buys rare books for Emory, I don't make such errors today. And I expect after my dismay at having my book so roughly treated, if beloved, that so does that student. She doesn't do that, I don't think, anymore. So I have to thank Olds and the copy of Satan Says she signed in July 1993 for giving me that lesson, never to loan out books. But I want to also thank her for far more than that. Olds' fierce generosity lets us know that poetry is never on loan, but a gift, a keeper. We should all thank her for letting us know what our lives are like even as we live them, rather than long after. Her brilliant poetic gifts are something to behold, to be given and kept, retold and treasured, to be seen and sung. Ladies and gentlemen, Sharon Olds.
Oh, thank you so much. Hi. I want to thank my brother in poetry, Kevin, for that wonderful welcome, and my thanks to Rosemary and to Emory. It's an honor to be here as part of the Raymond Danowski reading series. And little did I know, when I left the house at 5 this morning in New Hampshire, opening the door to see that 6 inches of snow had fallen during the night, that I would be arriving here to such beautiful first day of spring weather. On the plane, I thought, I want to start with a poem that I didn't write. And I thought of a poem by Lucille Clifton, partly because of memories of having been at a memorial in honor of Lucille with Kevin. And so I tried to write it down on the plane. I got pretty close with some of the lines, and then I found a copy of it in my notebook, so I'll try to say it part from memory. Won't you celebrate with me what I have shaped into a kind of life? I had no model, born in Babylon, both non-white and woman. What did I see to be except myself? I made it up. Here on this bridge between starshine and clay, my one hand holding tight my other hand, come celebrate with me that every day something has tried to kill me and has failed. Miss Lucille Clifton. Oh, it's so thrilling to be here, to see Natasha, to see see people. Diagnosis. Oh, and I'm going to read poems for the first half, and then we can have a conversation if there's anything you want to say or ask, and there are mics here. And then I'll close by another shorter set of poems. Diagnosis. By the time I was 6 months old, she knew something was wrong with me. I got looks on my face she had not seen on any child in the family or the extended family or the neighborhood. My mother took me in to the pediatrician with the kind hands, a doctor with a name like a suit size for a wheel, hub long. My mom did not tell him what she thought in truth, that I was possessed. It was just these strange looks on my face. He held me and conversed with me, chatting as one does with a baby. And my mother said, "She's doing it now. Look, she's doing it now." And the doctor said, "What your daughter has is called a sense of humor." "Oh," she said, and took me back to the house where that sense would be tested and found to be incurable. I forget now sometimes how unusual it was, how unusual poems with children in them were, and many of the poems that I was writing in my early years of writing were about children. So I thought I would like to read two of those. Exclusive for my daughter. I lie on the beach, watching you as you lie on the beach, memorizing you against the time when you will not be with me. Your empurpled lips, swollen in the sun and smooth as the inner lips of a shell. Your biscuit gold skin, glazed and faintly pitted like the surface of a biscuit. The serious knotted twine of your hair. I have loved you instead of anyone else, loved you as a way of loving no one else, every separate grain of your body building the God as you were built within me, a sealed world. What if from your lips I had learned the love of other lips, from your starred, gummed lashes the love of other lashes, from your shut, quivering eyes, the love of other eyes. From your body, the bodies. From your life, the lives. Today I see it is there to be learned from you, to love what I do not own. Rite of passage. As the guests arrive at our son's party, they gather in the living room, short men, men in first grade, with smooth jaws and chins. Hands in pockets, they stand around jostling, jockeying for place, small fights breaking out and calming. One says to another, "How old are you?" "6." "I'm 7." "So?" They eye each other, seeing themselves tiny in the other's pupils. They clear their throats a lot, a room of small bankers. They fold their arms and frown. "I could beat you up," a 7 says to a 6. The midnight cake, round and heavy as a turret, behind them on the table. My son, freckles like specks of nutmegs on his cheeks, chest narrow as the balsa keel of a model boat, long hands cool and thin as the day they guided him out of me, speaks up as a host for the sake of the group. We could easily kill a 2-year-old, he says in his clear voice. The other men agree. They clear their throats like generals. They relax and get down to playing war, celebrating my son's life. And this is a poem from the middle of a book that Kevin kindly mentioned, a book called The Father. I realize, you know, when I'm backstage, I'm both very deeply grateful for the generosity of what he's saying, and I don't quite connect it with myself in a way at all. But when I'm reading you the poems, I'm seeing how it was just ordinary things in an ordinary life that I wanted to put into poetry. And that's a lot why they came back very quickly in their self-addressed stamped envelopes, rejected from the magazines I was yearning to be a part of very quickly. You know, sometimes you put it in the mailbox and then you get back to your apartment and in your mailbox is the rejection slip. We don't know how they do it. But they do so much we don't know how they do, don't they? So this is a poem from the middle of that book, The Father. The race. When I got to the airport, I rushed up to the desk, bought a ticket. 10 minutes later, they told me the flight was canceled. The doctors had said my father would not live through the night, and the flight was canceled. A young man with a dark brown mustache told me another airline had a nonstop, leaving in 7 minutes. See that elevator over there? Well, go down to the first floor, make a right. You'll see a yellow bus. Get off at the second Pan Am terminal. I ran. I, who have no sense of direction, raced exactly where he'd told me, a fish slipping upstream deftly against the flow of the river. I jumped off that bus with those bags I had thrown everything into in 5 minutes and ran. The bags wagged me from side to side as if to prove I was under the claims of the material. I ran up to a man with a flower on his breast. I, who always go to the end of the line, I said, help me. He looked at my ticket. He said, make a left and then a right, go up the moving stairs and then run. I lumbered up the moving stairs. At the top, I saw the corridor. And then I took a deep breath. I said goodbye to my body, goodbye to comfort. I used my legs and heart as if I would gladly use them up for this, to touch him again in this life. I ran, and the bags banged against me, wheeled and coursed in skewed orbits. I have seen pictures of women running, their belongings tied in scarves grasped in their fists. I blessed my long legs he gave me. My strong heart I abandoned to its own purpose. I ran to gate 17, and they were just lifting the thick white lozenge of the door to fit it into the socket of the plane. Like the one who is not too rich, I turned sideways and slipped through the needle's eye, and then I walked down the aisle toward my father. The jet was full, and people's hair was shining. They were smiling. The interior of the plane was filled with a mist of gold endorphin light. I wept as people weep when they enter heaven in massive relief. We lifted up gently from one tip of the continent and did not stop until we sat down lightly on the other edge. I walked into his room and watched his chest rise slowly and sink again. All night, I watched him breathe. Always when I read a son poem, I read a daughter poem. When I read a father poem, I read a mother poem. So I'd like to read Wonder as Wander. At dusk, on those evenings she does not go out, my mother potters around her house. Her daily helpers are gone. There is no one there, no one to tell what to do. She wanders. Sometimes she talks to herself, fondly scolding. Sometimes she suddenly throws out her arms and screams, high notes lying here and there on the carpets, like bodies touched by a downed wire. She journeys. She Marco Polos. She quests through the gilded, gleamy loot rooms. Who is she? I feel now that I do not know her, and for all my staring, I have not seen her. Like the song she sang when we were small. I wonder as I wander out under the sky, how Jesus the Savior was born for to die for poor lonely people like you and like I. On the slow evenings alone, when she delays and delays her supper, walking the familiar halls past the mirrors and night windows, I wonder if my mother is tasting a life beyond this life, not heaven. Her late beloved is absent, her father absent, and her staff is absent. Maybe this is earth alone, as she had not experienced it. As if she is one of the poor, lonely people, as if she is born to die. I hold fast to the thought of her wandering in her house, a Luna moth in a chambered cage. 50 years ago, I'd squat in her garden with her red queen tulips and try to sense the flyways of the fairies as they kept the pollen flowing on its local paths and our breaths on their course of puffs. They kept our eyes wide with seeing what we could see and not seeing what we could not see. And I like to read a couple of poems from Stag's Leap. They're both kind of from the early part of the book. It's a book that was mostly written 15 years ago. But some of it 10, and maybe some of the last few poems 5. Known to be left. If I pass a mirror, I turn away. I do not want to look at her, and she does not want to be seen. Sometimes I don't see exactly how to go on doing this. Often when I feel that way, within a few minutes, I am crying, remembering his body or an area of it. I didn't say this is an end of long marriage book. I'll start that line over. Often, when I feel that way, within a few minutes, I am crying, remembering his body or an area of it. His backside, often, a part of him just right now to think of, luscious, not too detailed, and his back turned to me. After tears, the chest is less sore, as if some goddess of humanness within us has caressed us with a gush of tenderness. I guess that's how people go on, without knowing how. I am so ashamed before my friends to be known to be left by the one who supposedly knew me best. Each hour is a room of shame, and I am swimming, holding my head up, smiling, joking, ashamed, ashamed, like being naked with the clothed, or being a child, having to try to behave while hating the terms of your life. In me now, there's a being of sheer hate, like an angel of hate. On the badminton lawn, she got her one shot, pure as an arrow, while through the eyelets of my blouse, the no-see-ums bit the flesh no one seems now to care to touch. In the mirror, the torso looks like a pin-up hives martyr, or a cream pitcher speckled with henbit and pussy paws, full of the milk of human kindness and unkindness, and no one is lining up to drink. But look, I am starting to give him up. I believe he is not coming back. Something has died inside me, believing that, like the death of a crone in one twin bed as a child is born in the other. Have faith, old heart. What is living anyway but dying? Now I'm going to make a pause before reading another poem from Stag's Leap. And I'm going to read a couple more poems, and then we can have our conversation. For maybe 2 or 3 years, I've been writing odes. They suddenly began to appear to me shortly after a book of Neruda's odes almost fell off a used bookstore shelf into my hands, a facing page. I don't know why I had never gone deeply into his work, but then I did, and many, many odes began to come to me. Not necessarily the odes I would have wished would have come to me, such as this one. Douchebag ode. When I hear the young refer to someone as a douchebag, I want to say, you may have never seen a douchebag. They were red rubber bags like hot water bottles. You'd fill it and hang it high enough so that gravity... I can't go on. I see my mother's douchebag, my poor mom's pathetic douchebag with its clamps and its aorta tubes dangling over the bathtub, awesomely shameful, and which reminded me I'd been some kind of catsup Halloween costume in her almost before I was human. And so to call someone a saline sack, let's take some pity on the creepiness of how women were treated in the 1950s. It drove my mother crazy, but she did the best she could. She never turned and said, I could have got rid of you, my little Valentine, but I gave you the warm, rose-colored lunch bag of the placenta. I gave you my heart to eat. And now I remember it, not my mother's, but mine, like a dowry. Lock the door, then hang it from the shower rod like food hung over a bough out of wild animal reach. Slide the perforated wand inside you, then unclasp the clamp, and lo, you are a night clearing in which a fountain of Aphrodite leaps up and cascades down, making her music, her brine sea chanty, her sparkling douchebag song. My, my, my. I'll read one more poem before our conversation. This is a poem very special to me to be able to read in Atlanta. It was written in Atlanta. I was very inspired by meeting someone from here, and I was right there in the hotel, and I wrote this poem. Meeting a stranger. When I meet you, it's not just the two of us meeting. Your mother is there, and your father is there, and my mother and father, and our people, back from our folks back, are there, and what they might have had to do with each other, if one of yours and one of mine had met, what might have happened is there in the room with us. They are shadowy compared to us. They are quivers of reflected light on a wall. And if I were a German and you a Jew, or I a Jew and you a Palestinian, or as this morning when you are an African-American woman and I am a WASP, one of your family might have been taken from their home and brought through murder to murder by one of my family. It is there in the air with us. And if you're a woman in the city where you live, and I'm staying at the hotel where you work, and you have brought me my breakfast on a tray, though you and I have not met before, we are breathing in our lineages together. And whether there is guilt in the room or not, or blame, there is the history of human evil, and the shame in me that someone I could be related to could have committed against someone you are related to some horror. And in the room there is a question alive. Would I have risked harm to try to protect you, as I hope I would risk it for a cousin, a niece? Or would I have stood aside in the ordinary cowardice and self-interest of my flesh, now sharing your breath, your flesh, my breath? Thank you, and let's talk. There are these microphones here. Please, if you wish to, come up to one of them and ask me anything or tell me anything.
It's hard to stand up here and be the first one, but I think...
Thank you. Yeah.
I think probably we all experienced this moment of breathtaking surprise when you finished that last poem. And I have that experience very often when I read your poetry, and I was wondering, are you as surprised at the end of one of your poems as we, the reader, are?
Oh, thank you. I think that very often when we write a poem, we don't know where it's going. It may be that when we do know where it's going, doesn't turn out quite as well as when we don't. Or if we try to, push it in the direction we would have it go. But no, I think I almost never know where it's going to go. I know that I move to sing, and tell a story. I'm a storyteller. But what will happen by the end, I don't know. And sometimes I'll have an ending that is a ending that's basically horrible. And days later or minutes later, I'll realize that and see if I can work with it again. And often, if there's a statement, if I just put in the word not, not, it's truer for what that's worth. I'm not a confessional poet, but I'm a confessional Q&A woman. Questions and answers. Thank you. Yeah. What else? Hi.
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 I'd like to ask, and you could take any time period you want, but how has your teaching evolved? You've been teaching for a while.
How has my teaching evolved? Wonderful question. What has not changed in it is my gratitude when I can ever be useful to anyone for anything. I just practically get tears in my eyes when I, you know, I grew up in a very sinful theory, in sin theory, and so original sin theory. So the idea of not being a bad person is just so thrilling, that possibility that one isn't one of the worst people who exists. Oh, it's just so exciting. And teaching is a way of giving back from all of the teaching that has been given me, and my current students now, who are in their 20s, many of them, are teaching me all the time. I would say what has evolved is that I always now like to hear a poem first by ear, read in the voice of the poet, which I have not yet seen on the page. I am in love with poetry as an art of hearing. And it's so much older as that art than it is as the written art, which I love. I love poems on the page. But I like to hear the poem first when I haven't read it. And then I like to hear it a second time by someone else sitting next to the poet. And then we pass them around and start talking about them. And for the first month of the semester, I ask that no one make any suggestions for how to improve the poems, but just try to describe what the poem is like, what the voice is like, who is this creature, this poem on the page? What? And so by the end of a month or less, I feel we kind of know what the other poet is wanting to do, which may be very different from what we're wanting to do. Then we can say, I think you're doing what you want to do, and not just say, I'd prefer. So I guess that's just always been true for like 30 years of teaching, but my feeling about it is as strong now as it was then. And then, of course, when you're in conference, you can say exactly what you think once you know each other well enough and once people's feelings aren't going to get hurt too much. Yeah, and you can also tell people how wonderful they are, how really wonderful they are, which you might not, you know, say right in the group in the same way. Yeah. I think I saw you heading that way. Yes, please.
Yes, I just wanted to thank you for Stag's Leap, because this is my story also, 30-year marriage. And I thought I had finished with my grieving. This was just a few years ago, and someone gave me your book, and I just cried all the way through it for me and for you. And it really actually, you know, sort of put that finishing touch on my grieving. So thank you for being so personal in it, and yet you never cross that dangerous bridge of sentimentality. It's just wonderful that you can tell your story the way you do. So
thank you. All the hundreds of poems which cross that line no one has seen.
I wanted to ask you about the 15 years or 10 years or whatever that you waited on.
Yes, why I waited that long. I told my grown children when the divorce was first happening, that I would not write a book about it for at least 10 years. I don't think anyone would sign up to be the child of a family poet. There aren't like long lines in heaven, oh, I want to go there at all. So it's bad enough to be in the family of a family poet. And I just thought that would get, they would know that there would be a period of time where, I don't know, it would all, they could get used to it and it would all be closer to home. I did send out the poems to magazines and get them back and send them out. Because that's so much more of a small world that the general world isn't gonna, with all due respect to magazine editors, it's not as likely to get home to them. So I just thought it would give them a little breathing space. Yeah. Maybe one more. Yes, hi.
So I noticed most of your poems are kind of this one long big stroke. Could you talk a little bit about your views on form and structure and how that relates to the content?
Right, right. Thank you. I like that one stroke, but that my poems are kind of one long stroke. I never thought of it that way. I really like that that word. I say they're in one clump, but I like I like yours much better. Yeah, what's going on with that? I think that part of what's happening is that I love the sentence and I love the line, and my poems are a kind of caduceus or intimate relationship between the sentence and the line, and often the sentence ends in the middle of the line, and usually the rhyme is internal. I'm not saying I planned this, it's just I noticed this is how it was happening, and then I figured out that it was as a way of not imitating the hymns, the church hymns, and again, this wasn't just any church, this was a very severe, negative, hell-like, hell emphasis, right? So I didn't want my poems to sound at all like those hymns, although that's really what they're based on, with the rhymes taken away and the lines whipping down or curving down, putting a leg over down into the next line. So I think also to me, I write a poem in one stroke. Sometimes it takes a while, like 45 minutes. But any poems of mine that work well enough in my opinion that I want to show them to anyone are in one sweep in a way like that. So I have a little bit of a feeling, I think, of eagerness to get to the end, but not too soon. And I couldn't write in stanzas anymore. Occasionally, I'll have a poem that will have a break in it, but that's very rare, and it's for some really powerful reason. So just for me, I think it makes me feel independent enough that I can feel this is my form while I'm writing, and I'm not just imitating the forms of my childhood and adolescence and 20s, though I honor those forms in their absence in my work. Thank you. So I'll read a few more poems. Okay. I always bring a poem that I'm afraid to read, and sometimes I don't read them, and I'm always sorry afterwards if I don't read them. And here in this elegant city, I mean, to come to Atlanta, this is a new outfit I bought. I had to go get, I didn't have anything that I thought, Emory, no. So that's why I look better than usual. At the same time, if I feel this is too elegant a place for my inelegancies, I'm always sorry. So I'm going to read this ode. Ode to the penis. Someone told me that what I write about men is objectifying. So I ask you, O general idea of the penis, do you mind being noticed? You who stand in the mind, erect and not, old and young, for all your representations, O abstract principle, haven't you maybe been waiting for your turn to be sung? I think you're lovely and brave and so interesting. You are like a creature with your head and trunk, as if you have a life of your own. But you are innocent. You are not your own man. You are no more responsible for your actions than the matter of the brain for its thoughts. And you've had a mixed history. You've been taken into carnage as the instrument of it, and you yourself have been played to produce the desperate screams. Often you have not been protected, nor been used to protect, and oft not been respected, nor wielded to respect. And yet most of your history has been spent in joy. And I wonder how it has felt being so adored as you have been and feared, and what it is like for you if you could look down from your platonic cloud of categories when two of you are engaged together or married, yourself primed, yourself to your own power. And being a concept, are you smart? Do you know you're equal to your sister concept? And even that you came from her back at the invention of the separate male, the ovaries heavying down toward the earth, the organ of orgasm growing and growing. I cannot imagine you from within, but as a sage said of a god, I do not want to be sugar, I want to taste sugar. But that's just my heteromania talking. And you're not homo or hetero or visible or manifest. You do not exist except as an imaginary quorum of all your instances. So I'm not flirting with you. I'm just saying I like you, not as an object, but a subject, a prime mover, a working theory of plumbing and ecstasy, a boy's pride and anxiety, windsock of zephyr and gale, half of the equation of creation. Thank you. Well, I found out in the green room that this is the school that Chris McCandless of Into the Wild, the John Krakauer book and the Sean Penn movie, that this is where he went to school. And the scenes some of the scenes were shot here. And it's a long time ago now, while that movie was being written and made, that I got a call from a representative of Sean Penn asking if I would be willing to help work on the script and for a poem of mine to be used in the movie. And I said, oh, I don't know. No, I said, yes. In honor of all of the artists and people, the family members of the McCandless family, and all of the actors and makers of that movie, I thought I would read that poem here today in their honor. It's called "I Go Back to May, 1937." I see them standing at the formal gates of their colleges. I see my father strolling out under the ochre sandstone arch, the red tiles glinting like bent plates of blood behind his head. I see my mother with a few light books at her hip, standing at the pillar made of tiny bricks, the wrought iron gate still open behind her, its sword tips aglow in the May air. They're about to graduate. They're about to get married. They're kids. They're dumb. All they know is they're innocent. They would never hurt anybody. I want to go up to them and say, stop. Don't do it. She's the wrong woman. He's the wrong man. You are going to do things you cannot imagine you would ever do. You are going to do bad things to children. You are going to suffer in ways you have not heard of. You are going to want to die. I want to go up to them there in the late May sunlight and say it. Her hungry, pretty face turning to me, her pitiful, beautiful, untouched body, his arrogant, handsome face turning to me, his pitiful, beautiful, untouched body. But I don't do it. I want to live. I take them up like the male and female paper dolls and bang them together at the hips like chips of flint, as if to strike sparks from them. I say, do what you are going to do, and I will tell about it. I think I would like to actually read all three of these poems. Then I'll stop. I just want to put a different tone of music into my own ear about family after the last one I just read. San Francisco Bay Dawn Song. When I have come down from thousands of feet up in the mountains down to sea level to the shore of my birth, it is clear to me that I would have protected my mother from her mother if I could have. But it was so hard to get at her, that grandmother, from where I was, still deep inside my child mother. I had, as yet, no arms or legs, no head, no power to heal my mother's mother. If I had existed, if I had had the wings of the morning, I would have taken that large, turbulent, cold one on. I would have walked in when she was in a room alone, my mother's mother, and spoken to her. But I was noxed up so tight in her daughter. I wish I could have sung to that daughter, my mother, from within her, sung to the crux and rip of her ravage in her own mother's house. I want to be able to go back there, though as yet without the breath of the earth or a mouth, though missing half of myself, to release into my mother's young life some whole notes, some spirit-level bubbles, golden burps of song to rise within her and softly break open in her throat. There. Now I can sink back down into the sleep of the clutch in her side, down into the reeds where the local feathered heads and necks are pulling from underneath the wading bird wings. And in the pox of the tidal mud, the brine is rising now, and light is touching it from thousands of feet, thousands of miles in the air. Among my favorite books that I'd read before last summer is Evie Shockley's book of poems, The New Black. And in it, there's an amazing poem, Ode to My Blackness. And after I had been reading that a while, I wrote this. Ode to My Whiteness, after Evie Shockley. You were invisible to me. You went without saying. You were my weapon secret from myself. Whatever I got, you helped get it for me. You were my ignorance. Because of you, I was not innocent. I did not see that. You were my blinding light. My dreams had a blank area in the center, taking up most of the screen they played on in my sleep, a blazing circle that blanked out the core of the scene. I thought it was my mother's violence, but it was you, too. You, the unseen fat which fed me in the wilderness. You, my Masonic handshake. You, my silence. You, my drone. You, my collaborator. You, my magician's cloak of steam. You, my dissembler. You, mine. I, yours, irisless eyeball. Evie's blackness, a dancer. You, another. The two of you shimmering together. And I'd like to close with this, with my thanks so much for your kind welcome and your good company. Ode to the Hymen. I don't know when you came into being inside me, when I was inside my mother. Maybe when the involuntary muscles were setting like rose jello. I love to think of you then, so whole, so impervious, you and the clitoris as safe as the life in which you were housed. They would have had to kill both my mother and me to get at either of you. I love her at this moment as the big fortress around me, the matron head around the sweetmeat of my maidenhead. I don't know who invented you to keep a girl's inwards clean and well cupboarded. Dear wall, dear gate, dear style, dear Dutch door, not a cat flap nor a swinging door, but a one-time pinata. How many places in the body were made to be destroyed once? You were very sturdy, weren't you? You took your job seriously. I'd never felt such pain. You were the woman the magician saws in two. I was proud of you, turning to a cupful of the bright arterial ingredient. And how lucky we were, you and I, that we got to choose when and with whom and where and why. Plush pincushion, somehow related to statues that wept. It happened on the rug of a borrowed living room, but I felt as if we were in Diana's woods, he and I and you together, or as if we were where the magma from the core of the earth burst up through the floor of the sea. Thank you for your life and death. Thank you for your flower girl walk before me, throwing down your scarlet petals. It would be years before I married, years before I carried within me a tiny baby hymen, near the eggs with other teensy hymens within them, but you unscrolled the carpet, leading me into the animal life of a woman. You were a sort of blood mother to me. First you held me close for 18 years, and then you let me go. Thank you.
The preceding program is copyrighted by Emory University.